Solo Mama. Welcome to Coffee House, number 161. It's the first one after 2 years, and it's only happening, right? I'm so excited about it, and I just want to take this moment just to acknowledge and remember those people that were part of the Coffee House, member of the Coffee House, and passed away in those 2 years. It's Chris Kapp and Michael Arian, who actually founded and started this program. It's John Maida, who was here in every Coffee House. It's Jean-Claude Van Italy. It's George Ferenz. I know, I didn't know, it just came to me now. I don't know if I'm, if there are any more names, just,
Tim
Sherenbaum, even though it was before, before the pandemic, so I think it's, we're taking this moment just to honor them and to remember them. Having said it, I just want to say that we have a very promising, I think, program. We have 6 Coffee House this coming season, and actually it's going to be back to back. So this is the first one, and I'm so happy to start with these amazing ladies. Hey, hey. 2 weeks from now, it's Penny Arcade. It's going to be moderated by Sarah Schulman, and we're going to have a lot of guests, maybe way too many. And then 2 weeks later, it's going to be Peter Hooger, the photographer. And then there are 3 more names that I'm not going to reveal right now because we just have to get a final for final dates. Okay, so about it, let's start. And
I think you want to talk.
Yes,
these I have been flipped over, turned upside down, in the best possible way, by Spiderwoman Theater. The force of these women have helped shape the legacy of La Mama and this community, and their impact and influence has rippled out over multiple generations of artists. Many of them are here today, and we are blessed and honored.
Before we start, we would like to recognize and acknowledge the Indigenous people who respected the spirit of the earth before us. Wherever we are at this moment, the land beneath our feet has been, by others, maintained before us. I would like to honor with gratitude the land itself and the people who cared for it through many generations. We know significant events took place that took the protection away from the land where we sit or stand now. We also know the sweetness from the berries and the love and joy shared among the ancestors. This is why we are still here. We cannot change the past, but can acknowledge it, and the contributions and experiences of Native peoples, and in tribute to them, pay homage and learn how to be in better relationship to the land we all inhabit. I'm Carey Lovelace of Loose Change Productions, like a clumsy person, and a writer, curator, critic, and sometime producer on this crazy roller coaster of theater life. And I'm so honored to be moderating this afternoon dedicated to the amazing Spiderwoman Theater. And Spiderwoman. And it's going to be a retrospective journey through their iconic career, and many thanks to La Mama's Cafe Chronicles and to La Mama itself for bringing these vital chapters of downtown theater life alive again. I myself was around the East Village scene back in the day, and one group left an indelible impression on me, and that was Spiderwoman. Oscar Eustace of the public theater called Spiderwoman one of the most influential Native theater companies in the history of the country. and it holds a unique place in the downtown universe as well. One of the things that marks Spiderwoman is their humor. Now, I wish I could tell a joke right here and insert joke here, but I'm not very funny, so I can't match Muriel and Gloria, so I'll have to leave it up to them to provide the stories and the humor. From its wildly in-your-face feminist beginnings to its current massive story-weaving collaborations across this continent and beyond, Spiderwoman's message is very much shaped by the New York avant-garde, an avant-garde that La Mama Theater helped nurture and helped incubate, and all the crazy theater makers of the 1970s and 1980s with whom they've worked along the way, some of whom we're lucky to have here today, so thank you to them. At the heart of everything has been three sisters, the inimitable Muriel Miguel, its founder, Gloria Miguel with her remarkable stage presence, always. And Lisa Mayo. This afternoon is actually dedicated to the memory of Lisa, who died in 2013. Like her sister, she was a bawdy broad and a memorable theater pro through and through. Her presence will be with us this afternoon as we voyage from their childhood in Brooklyn, of all places, through the experiments of through the experiments of 1960s theater, to the first incarnation of Spiderwoman as a crazy feminist collective, to its consolidation of a group of three sisters with a sharp lens on Native issues and beyond. Along the way up there, you'll see visuals capturing the rich history. And since this is downtown theater, there will be plenty of rough patches, and that's how we roll. We have a lot to cover. We actually, in theory, are supposed to be out of here by 5, so I hope you don't mind me being a little bit of a drill sergeant cutting things short in the middle of people talking. But I'm sure, we're here, there'll be, ample content, even if you're kind of marching through very quickly. Around 2010, Spiderwoman began to bring in other Native voices and other generations. The afternoon will conclude with an in-process snippet from their current ambitious 4-year-long collaborative project, Misdemeanor Dream, which will, mark your calendars, be presented at La Mama starting on March 19th. So we're gonna begin today. We have like 5 different chapters we're moving through, the early life, the Spiderwoman Theater as feminist collective, and so forth. We're gonna kick this off with a short performance by Muriel and Gloria, but before we do that, we'd like to we'd like to honor another member of the family, Kevin Tarrant, from the Bear Clan of the Ho-Chunk Nation of Wisconsin and the Sky Clan of the Hopi Tribe of Arizona. Kevin left us in the summer of 2020, which was late spring, carried away by the great plague from which we have all been suffering so much in so many ways. Beloved son-in-law of Muriel, nephew of Gloria, husband of Muriel Boris Tarrant, father of Josephine, he was the leader of the Silver Cloud Singers, and he characteristically opened many performances and gatherings with a tribute song, often playing the large drum, making it vibrate with some ear-splitting, body-shaking source of deep truth. And now, Louis Mofsie will present a song in tribute to Kevin.
Oh, tell you this. The last time we did this piece was 3 years ago. When I could walk. Okay.
Thank you.
So, could Louis, could you come to the stage, and Lance Richmond, can you come also?
Start off a little bit talking about where you started, about origins. I'm trying to find a way to face you.
Okay.
And, you know, it's been amazing for me to get to know you and also the rich history and the stories that I've heard through the course of knowing you. And I was wondering if everyone maybe here could introduce themselves by their name and where they come from, and would that be appropriate
sure.
to do that? So, Muriel, could you start?
My name is Muriel Miguel. My name is Bright Sun. My name is Waga Nadili. I am Kuna and Rappahannock, and my mother and father met in Brooklyn. They married in Brooklyn. They had their children in Brooklyn. So I'm truly a city Indian.
My name is Gloria Miguel, Dukopsis. And we were both born on the floor, so I always like to say that. in Brooklyn. And another thing, it's buried under a tree in the backyard.
Okay.
Our, what do you call those things?
Placenta.
Buried under a tree.
She knows the story.
And the backyard, so and that's also interesting. It makes me feel like a true Brooklynite.
Okay.
And,
My name is Louis Mofsie, and I am from two tribes. My father is from the Hopi tribe from Arizona, and my mother is from the Winnebago tribe from Nebraska. I am the director of the Thunderbird American Indian Dance Company, and I'm very happy to say that we're celebrating our 58th year this year. Without question, we're the oldest Native American resident dance company in New York City. But I was also born in Brooklyn, New York, and I'm a city Indian.
My name is Lance Richmond. I'm the son of Rosemary Richmond and David Richmond, Mohawk from Akwesasne, but also grew up most of my life in downtown Brooklyn, a few blocks from the Gross Street.
Hello, my name is Hinu Josephine Tarrant.
Yep, yep.
I am Ho-Chunk, Hopi, Rappahannock, and Kuna. And I am Muriel's granddaughter, and Gloria's grandniece, and Uncle Louie's grandniece, and Lance's niece as well, and godchild. And I'm from Jersey City and New York City. And I'm the interim managing director of Safe Harbors NYC. And I'm also a part of the Safe Harbors Ensemble, and I'm also a part of the Ensemble for Misdemeanor Dreams that's opening here in March. And that's
so and Safe Harbors is part of La Mama too, is that not? Is that
Safe Harbors, yeah, I'll do a little pitch. So we have an annual festival called the Reflections of Native Voices Festival. And this year it'll be hosted in June between New York Theater Workshop and La Mama. Some of you might be familiar, some of you may not, but third annual year this year. And yeah, we're very excited. We're going to be bringing Spiderwoman in to talk about directing, and as well as Dak and lots of other folks who are also part of the downtown theater scene. So yeah, we're very excited for that.
Great, thank you. So your parents, your father came from the Cuna land, and could you talk a little bit about that and also the house you grew up in? It was a legendary place. I'd love to hear more about that.
My father came, is it on?
Yeah.
Came from off the coast of Panama, a place called Cuniala, and he worked on big 4- and 5-mast schooners, and that's how he came to Brooklyn, because that's where the schooner moored, I guess, docked. I think he was surprised. The story goes like this. He had another friend that was another Native guy that was on the same schooner as he, and he was getting all dressed up to go see our family. And he said to my father, why don't you come along? They have a sister. She has a sister. And so my mother was sitting at the window looking and waiting for these guys to come in. And she saw my father, and she said, I'm going to marry him. That's the story. That's the family story.
And was that in the Red Hook area of Brooklyn where you have your house?
DeGraw Street is, I don't know what it's called anymore. It used to be called Red Hook, and it was now it's called, you know, Carroll Gardens, and I don't know. It was called Gowanus at one time. So I don't know. All I know is getting very shishy.
That's good from those days. Anyway, and the placenta is buried in the shishi.
It's still there.
But your house was like really a center, right, where people came and hung out and passed through, and it was. Didn't you say that? Somebody was traveling in Panama, and they knew that. They said, "Oh, the house on."
Yeah, it was my daughter. She went out to Panama up in the mountains, and she was in a top with the punas, and she mentioned where her mother was born, and one of the punas said, I was there once. but it was at the time when it was called Red Hook, it was an Italian neighborhood. So that's another one of our influences. We were born in an Italian neighborhood, and my father worked on the docks, on the waterfront, you know, every morning. But he was called out, and they liked him very much. So it wasn't easy living in Brooklyn in an Italian neighborhood. You know, and we had to get used to a lot of the racism and walking down the street, people going, woo, woo, woo. And I remember one time we performed for a group of psychiatrists, and I asked them, I said, how come you picked our group? And he said, identity. We kept our identity somehow through all that. We had all kinds of, I was thinking about it, you know. I grew up with Louis' older brother who passed away, and we lived next door to each other at one time. We made a hole in the backyard fence and we used to go around, you know, around and around and have all kinds of fun and fights and food, and to this day I wear a ring that his father gave my mother and my mother gave to me. So we have a lot
of history. So how did you get into showbiz? Because there was a sort of performing aspect that came in pretty early on, right?
Well, this is way before my time. But there were all these, it was the, there was all these different shows that ran across the country, Wild West shows. And a lot of Native people came through, and a lot of them were stranded in New York City. And my father and mother felt that it was really important to see these people. And so a lot of the people we knew, my mother saw someone standing in the cold under a street lamp. She went home, got my father, so she says he looks like he's Native. You know, he looks like he's Indian. He went out, talked to the guy, and he stayed with us for at least 10 years. He was a trick rider, too. It was quite exciting for me, and I was like three on. I thought he was my brother. And then I think Louis's family and our family, we met, Louis didn't meet. Our parents met, and there was a lot of talk together, and I think they did shows together. And I don't know about how Louis felt about the shows, but a lot of those shows were really, my father, during the hard times in Brooklyn, you know, he made patented...
alcohol?
Well, it wasn't. It was water with coloring and...
medicine. He was like snake oil. So.
Well, it was really snake oil. And then he put it in fancy little bottles and he would sell it on the... He would put his outfit on and sell it on the corners. Not very proud things to talk about, but it's true.
Well, our family valued a float.
John
Wayne movies.
Right. I heard something. Wasn't there a John Wayne movie where he walked
not,
out?
Maybe Louis knows about that. But the longest trail, was that it? The long trail?
What,
that was a Tom Hanks movie?
Me?
Yeah. We weren't born movie, no. Yeah. But there were these long trailers. And we have pictures of it. Naughty's in it, and your father, and my father, and you know, they're all up on this trailer with horses dragging this thing, and it says the longest trail, you Western coming to the USA or something like that. We have pictures of that.
I just like to say a few things too. You know, what we're talking about here is that we were up at a time and we were dealing with a tremendous amount of stereotypes about Native American people. And I think that's one of the things that I think is so wonderful about Spiderwoman and, you know, the Thunderbirds and other groups that have been doing that. They have been trying all of these years to, you know, address those stereotypes that people have had about Native American people. And I'm sad to say that even today in 2022, there's so many people out there who still have those stereotypes about who we are and what we're all about. And I think what Miriam was talking about, I think that's a very important thing for us, and Gloria has just said it too, identity. It's not just identity, but we're also looking for the respect that all people have, which we have not been given. I'm so happy this afternoon that we acknowledge the place we're in today. That is something that has never been done. That's only happened, I think, in the last 2 or 3 years. But what happened before that? I think those are the kind of things that the Spiderwoman Theater have addressed. It's the kind of things that we try to address when we do our dance performances. We try to educate people about the richness and how much we have and how much we want to share. But we want to share that in a way where we're equal to everyone else and where we have the same respect that we give everyone else. We want to have that respect, and that's what this is all about. And I think that's part of what Spiderwoman has been doing for all these years, and their work has been fantastic, and I think they have helped. They have really helped in so many ways to have more people understand who we are and what we are and to gain that respect.
And I just want to acknowledge that Muriel, Boris Parent, has come on. Would you introduce yourself with your
My voice? Name is Muriel Boris Parent. I had to... it's in my DNA not to be on time. But I tried. I'm the daughter of Muriel Miguel, and I'm the niece of Gloria Miguel, and this is my uncle, Louis. You know, I'm sure you, my brother-in-law and my daughter. And what else do you want me to say?
Oh, just the name, your name.
Oh, okay, bye.
No, your name, your
oh,
name.
I said my name.
No, your name, name.
My name, name?
Yeah.
Which
one
name?
One we gave you.
Huh?
Ask your mother.
What did you want to say?
Sorry. So I just want to talk a little bit about the Thunderbird dancers, because you and Louis founded that together, and I just wondered if you could talk about that and what led to the founding of it, because you were both really pretty young when you founded that, right?
Yeah, one of the pictures we had up earlier, if I don't know whether you noticed or not, was myself, you, and Kevin's brother and father, Josephine, and Sam doing the Thunder Dance. And this was a little over 50 years ago. I had a laugh when you said,
look at those lights.
The piece you did just now, you just did a little over 3 years ago. Well, that's a dance we did a little over 50 years ago.
Yeah.
So, anyhow. But yes, Muriel and I grew up together. In fact, Muriel was one of the founding members of the Thunderbird American Indian Dance Company. And we actually grew up in an area downtown Brooklyn where there was a Mohawk little community. And I think that's one of the things also that we also, you know, have thought about so many times, because people think that there were no Native American people living here in New York City. And they would look at us and say, well, you're not real Native American people. And we say, why is that? Because the real Native people come from out west. If you live west of the Mississippi, you're real. If you live on this side, you're a fake. And I think that's one of the kind of things, it's true. It's one of the kind of things that we felt, and right here in Brooklyn, New York, there was a community of Mohawk iron workers that lived there. They're the ones who put up the Empire State Building. They're the ones that put up George Washington Bridge. They all lived there during the week. And on the weekends, they would travel back up to their home in Canada, up the Caughnawaga Mohawk reservations. But we became part of that community because that was the only Native kind of gathering that was around. And so we got to know a lot of the Mohawk people. And as youngsters, we knew the dances and songs from our parents, my mother and my father, and of course, Muriel and her family learned a little bit from the Kuna people. And so we started to sing and we started to dance. And so we wanted to expand. We wanted to learn other dances and other songs. So we went to the Iroquois people, the Mohawks, and we started learning their songs and dances. And then from that, we grew, we said, well, you know, there's so many other tribes out there. Why don't we learn their songs and their dances? And we started traveling, learning the songs and dances of different groups. And then we said, let's bring that all back to New York City, and let's do it here in New York, and let these people who have never traveled out to the West, haven't had a chance to meet all of these different tribes, let's bring all of those dances back here and tell the stories, tell the background, tell the reason for these dances. And that was one of the things also, so that when you go to the movies and you see these people dance, you have no idea of what they're doing. But each of these dances had a reason, it had a purpose. And so that was part of what we were working on, trying to get these stories. And that's exactly what Spiderwoman is doing also. The stories of the dances. And there are stories that tell what these dancers are doing, why they do them, what's the reason. And I think that's part of what we've been working on. As youngsters, we started doing that. I think we've been doing that, and we still are doing it, which is great. And I'm so happy we are.
So, I mean, I'm so sorry because our time is so short, but I wanted to talk a little bit about the American Indian Community House. A lot of the pictures that we see, like this one right here, are Rosemary Richmond, who's the mother of Lance Richmond. And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about, you know, because it's been played an important role and still is existing today.
And I'll be quick. First, is, you know, before we all know these people as titans, leaders. I just knew them as uncles and aunts, you know, growing up. And didn't really realize what world I was in. You know, it was just normal to go to powwows, to go to shows, to see plays. I saw Woman in Violence at the American Indian Community House in 1975, maybe, six.
Yeah.
And that was my first play, and as a kid, I wasn't like, what is this? This is, and I'm like, do I say anything? Do I not say anything? It was, you know, it was interesting.
He knew all the dirty jokes.
I don't remember that. But they set a great foundation for our community, for me, a safe place for a lot of artists, people, youth. You know, it was very, in fact, just a few blocks away on Lafayette, there were several decades where we had, a great facility, performances almost every weekend. It was just a great environment that I think some of us take for granted or did or didn't realize how special it was. But my generation, certainly, and those after, owe a lot to the people on this stage for giving us that safe space to sort of feel comfortable and figure out how we wanted to create, following the examples in our own ways. And hopefully the community house can, in my mother's memory, in the decades that she led the ship, keep on doing that for the generations to come.
Can I just say, there's kind of a beeping sound. I don't know what that's coming from.
It's actually people responding for the emergency that everybody gets. So if you can help, try to check your phone and see if it's on.
If we turn it all off, it'll all go off. Because every single person's phone is just going to keep going off.
It's a state of emergency.
All right. What's the emergency?
Yeah.
What's the emergency?
There's no flurry.
Well, all right, so. So, Lance, what was the actual founding purpose of the AICH?
Well, I mean, I think Uncle Louie was involved in that. I wasn't born yet, but it was just to provide a safe space, a house, for people, Native people in Manhattan. Yeah, well, that's what I mean. It's, all different programs, reasons to come, but it's even to just meet other Natives that you didn't know. I mean, if you come to the city, it's a big city. So it was, to provide resources, things that people may need in our community. Some of that is, having a safe space to rehearse and, rehearse your art, or even just come see theater performances or dance performances. We had, during our heyday, we had food banks, clothing banks. We had our own gallery on Broadway in Lafayette. So it's just really servicing as much as we can the needs of the Native community.
I have a funny story to tell. I was a receptionist at the American Community House for about 10 years or so.
Speak into the mic.
I was a receptionist at the community, and I used to, when I walked through the streets in New York, you don't see many Natives. Once in a while you see a Native. And three times I was walking through the neighborhood, uptown, downtown, and three guys told me one time, at different times, that they followed me to the community house. And they found the community. I thought that was so wonderful. They just followed me. I worked there and everything. So
you are a magnet for the community. Yeah. That's what I'm talking about. So I feel so badly because this could be like a whole thing in itself. But to plow through all the rest of what we need to get through, we have to sort of bring it to a close. But I invite you to learn more about Louis Mofsie and the American Thunderbird American Indian Community House. These are like iconic performers, and we're going to hear more from Josie and from Muriel also later on. So
I just want to say that it really makes me really feel good and really warms my heart to know that we, all of us, have family. Our parents, our mothers, our fathers, our uncles, that really spawn us. We would not be who we are if we did not have people there and we were Native, and that we were told we were Native, and we were not ashamed of it. And that's what a lot of places it happened, that people were ashamed of it. We were not. We were in the city, and we were not. We were proud. And so, you know, looking around and seeing other people come in, I really feel that warmth. I really feel that feeling in me of how proud I am that there are people out there that belong to us.
So we're going to go to our next chapter now. Thank you so much. And then could Paul and Ellen come on stage and set up?
Can we go? Can we leave?
No, you have to stay.
Oh, we have to stay. I could go, right? I can leave. Who said?
No.
Whatever.
So, are you ready, Ellen? Are you ready to perform?
Shall we go there?
Yeah. So part of what makes Spiderwoman Spiderwoman is this rich history, but another part that's there also shaping things in the sense of theater and art is the kind of climate that was around in the 60s, the early 70s, the kind of creative ferment that was in the New York scene. There were kind of the groups like Living Theater, there were groups like the Ontological Hysterical Theater, there was like early feminism, there's all sorts of stuff going on. And one group that was particularly pivotal was the Open Theater of Joseph Chaykin. That was a group that brought in a lot of very talented people. Was in existence for how long, Paul, would you say?
I joined it in 67. I joined it in 1967 and stayed there until 73 when it disbanded, but it actually started, I think, in around 64.
And then, you know, I think that there was the Open Theater, there were also other rivulets of influence, like Gloria. Didn't you study with Herbert Blau a little bit at
Oberlin? I received a scholarship to go to Oberlin College and study. I studied theater at Oberlin, and my husband at that time was a professor. Herbert Blau is there, and he taught some classes, and I was one of the members.
And didn't you also, wasn't Bill Irwin there?
Bill Irwin was one of the instructor.
Yeah, and you learned about clowning and stuff.
Yeah, he taught me a little bit how to be a clown.
Isn't she hilarious?
Paul was saying that you also were attended the Open Theater. You worked and were in a workshop.
Oh, I did a workshop with the winter's
project.
The Winter Project.
I did one of the shows with him. Not in the Winter Project.
She did
the summer. Yeah.
She's only spring and summer.
There's so many things that I did. I don't remember them all. I'm 95 years old.
Yeah. Really? I know, that's right.
No.
It's good to still be, I know, during the last two years, I also joined a group of people at West Fest. You're never too old to play.
I'm
still in that group.
So could you talk a little bit, Paul and Ellen, about the Open Theater? Because I'm wondering, and also Muriel, like, it feels like there was a kind of a sensibility or something that was there. And what did, I actually What did they do? What was that? I don't even know what the Open Theater did.
What did we do?
What did you do?
You start.
Okay. So for those of you who don't know, the Open Theater was a theater directed by Joseph Chaykin. It was a seminal theater in that it was one of the first theaters that created work collectively with an ensemble of people, and it influenced a lot of other theaters. And I think, you know, the 60s when we were formed was, as you know, was a very turbulent time, it was a very fraught time, it was also a very exciting time. And we felt, you know, that we were trying to create a theater that was breaking conventions. We felt, I think Joe particularly, he was coming out of a theater from the 50s that felt was very stifling and had a very kind of narrow sense of what people are and what they could be. And that translated into a kind of narrow vocabulary in the theater. And we want to expand that and see, imagine other parts of people and what was possible and find theatrical means of expressing that. So it was a research theater trying to figure out how to do that. It was a political theater because we were involved in the politics at the time. And we felt it was very exciting because we felt we were at the center of history and influencing our history as we were working.
Was it a kind of collage? I mean, how did you develop material?
Well, there were a lot of ways, but what was interesting was the discussion and all of us talking and all of us talking about our feelings and how did we get to a certain sentence of that feeling. That was one of the things. I was brought in because Joe thought that he really needed actors that could move. And he went to Lynn Laredo, remember her, and who was my first teacher in Laban, and he asked her if she knew actors that could move. And she said, well, I have a lot of dancers, and she brought me in and a couple of other people. But the amazing thing about that was that as soon as I saw these exercises, I knew them. I knew exactly where he was going. And that was so exciting to me because, you know, I was a dancer and I was at Henry Street Playhouse and it really felt like I was going upstream and everyone was going downstream. I was too fat, my breasts were too big, and you know, all of that was going up because you're not to have that when you're a dancer, dears. So that was, you know, a part of it. So when I saw these exercises, I knew exactly what they were and I knew where they were going and I understood them. And that's how I came into Open Theater. And the excitement of that, the excitement to get up and improvise and really take in and have things thrown at you like a what if. And there was another one about expectation. And that was really exciting to put two people on stage and you don't know where you're going, but you have a thing. It's called what if, it's called expectation. And then he went into storytelling. Now, storytelling was something I really knew about. I mean, storytelling, our stories came from under the kitchen table. You know, how Uncle Joe made Aunt Lizzie, somebody was drunk, and, you know, all wonderful things for kids to really listen to, you know. And I loved it. I loved it. And so when Joe talked about telling stories, you know, people would say, Muriel, you're such a wonderful storyteller. And I was thinking, what do you mean? I know this from my toenails up. You know, that storytelling really meant something to us. The creation stories, any of the creation stories, and the creation stories of us as family. and where it went. And that was exciting about open theater. I sometimes think with open theater, it was I was a little odd for them. I still had those feelings of I was going another way and other people were going another way. And sometimes it was Ellen Stewart that got me an audition that Open Theater knew about. And the people in Open Theater, I'm not saying everyone, but the people in Open Theater knew about, but they wouldn't tell me. And when Ellen Stewart found out that I didn't know, she called up the agent and said, "You didn't take her. Why isn't she called?" You know. So, you know, I didn't get the job, but I got the audition, you know. And so a lot of things, you know, you have to navigate. I'll always love Joe. I mean, sitting there and battling with all the stuff the stuff that came up, who's racist, who isn't racist. I mean, we're talking about this a long time ago. Who's a homophobe, who isn't a homophobe. You know, that all of that stuff was talked about then. That, how long ago is that? Yeah, it's over 50 years, right? So that's that the dance forms that I took really were the ones. When I started to think of storytelling and how do you work storytelling and what are the sounds and how deep the sounds are. And then, with you know, here we have split bridges in front of us, you know. I remember with Lois, we did the first idea I had of story weaving. And it came from three of us being in a church, Washington Square Methodist Church, no longer there. I think it's an apartment building. And we talked about this, the three of us. Now, Josephine Mofsie Tarrant, Louis' sister and my best friend, was part of this. And she wanted to do Spiderwoman. She wanted to do creation stories. And we put her on three blocks, and she was a wonderful finger weaver. And we put down the weaving that she was doing, and she told Spiderwoman stories as she was finger weaving. Lois had this wonderful dream that she made love to Jesus Christ. And it was so exciting. And again, you know, so...
So we're jumping a little ahead here, because you're supposed to bring them up and tell the story.
And there she was, right? And then myself, I just came back from the Sundance, and I talked to butterflies, so the whole thing about butterflies. And that was the beginning, really, of story weaving, because we talked about the depth of each a sound and the depth of the word itself. And how do we communicate? And I put in, do you remember this? A long river. And we were all on different sides of the river. And Josephine was up on this, I don't know what they were, square boxes or something, weaving. And that was the beginning of story weaving for me.
Well, now we don't have to do the next segment.
Oh, sorry. Listen, they have a lot of stories.
But before they come up, I just want to ask, one thing I had was, you know, you use a lot of personal stories, you know. In the open theater, did you use personal stories, or was it just, there was that delving into kind of autobiography and difficult?
Yeah, I was only there the last 3 years, but so I didn't overlap with Muriel, but I remember when I first came, there was the day where we could tell personal stories, and I told the story about my grandmother. She was from a foreign country, and I was very suspicious of her as a child, and one time I was yelling at her, and I fell forward, and this big bump came on my head, and she was chasing me with a butter knife, and because I think she wanted to put something cold on it, but I thought she was so dumb, because she was from a different country, that she wanted to cut off the bump. And that was the first story I told in the open theater, and then they let me be in the next play after that.
So why did the open theater end? then after that, you started the talking band, right?
The reason it ended because Joe felt it was had become too successful. It had become too successful.
Oh,
that
it
become true. That was a danger of becoming an institution, and he just wanted to move on to do other things. And most of the company, we were at the peak of our form. We were kind of horrified, but in retrospect, it was a really smart choice that he made, and it freed us up to do our own work. And Ellen and I and Tina Shepherd, who are in that company, formed the Talking Band. Muriel and Lisa and Gloria went on to do Spiderwoman. And I think, you know, we brought, I think I was talking with Muriel the other day, and she said, you know, we all, she and I came out of the same bathtub. Which I thought was a good way of putting it. But I think that bathtub that we came out of has influenced our work.
Pause for
it is a timer. It's a timer.
No, no, it's an alert. It's a weather alert.
Okay.
No, I know.
Okay.
So, okay.
But anyway, you know, we still brought together this kind of love of telling stories, a kind of sense of theater as a political statement, either whether you're consciously doing it or by default, and so you had to make a choice. A love of music, a love of movement. So I just feel it's really lucky that Spider Women and Talking Band will be performing at the same time at La Mama. They're going to be upstairs. We'll be here starting March 11th. And not only that we're performing with the preeminent native feminist theater. When we're doing a piece that Ellen wrote called Lemon Girls or Art for the Artless, which is about older women and a celebration of them. So there's a kind of a resonance.
So, Ellen, are you going to do a show?
Yeah, so Ellen's going to do a song from that show.
So the man swoops in with his empty cup.
because of Joseph Chaykin and then the Open Theater. So we have to march through to the future. So I'd like to welcome to the stage Peggy Shaw and Lois Weaver of the original Spiderwoman and the Split Witches. We have a little bit of a spoiler alert. I had always wondered where the, you know, how Spiderwoman began. So that story about the, you know, Hopi goddess, the story you were telling, that was the very beginning. So you were. Were you still in the Open Theater then, or you had sort of broken away? Or?
I was with Open Theater, and I wasn't with Open Theater. Yeah. I had my own idea, and I started to go around and look at other people and what other people were doing, and I started to collect women to I
started to collect women to bring them into workshops, and is that how I met you, Lois? Yeah.
You were collecting women?
Yeah.
I was lucky enough to be collected. Yes, you had a group of women already, and you very reluctantly let me into the group.
Well, you were white.
I was white, but I was also young, because I was 2 years out of college, I was 2 years in New York, and you were older, slightly more experienced. You invited me to come. You met once a week. We met once a week for several months. And it was the most peculiar practice I had ever experienced, because we would get together and we would talk about our husbands and boyfriends and children and delve without any particular purpose, it seemed to me, into these details of our lives. And then maybe at a certain point, somebody might have an idea for an exercise and we'd lie down on the floor and do something. And then we'd get up and go out to eat and drink. And we did that for months. And
yeah,
we still do that. I know that's my concern. That is the basis of our practice. Yeah. But I was so, first of all, I couldn't believe that we delved so deeply and so personally so quickly, for the one thing. But that was the beginning, and it was not until someone invited us, and it was this avant-garde music group, which I can't remember, and they were doing some evening called New Wilderness or New Territory.
That's
or
right.
New Horizons.
New Wilderness.
I think it was New Wilderness.
Yeah.
And they were doing an evening, and they said, do you want to do something? And we hadn't done much else but lie on the floor and go out to eat. And up until then, and to great effect, but we had only done that. And we said, yeah, let's, you said, yeah, let's. And that's what started. Then we became something a group doing things. And
what
started.
Was the first thing that you did? Was it Women in Violence, or what was the first?
The very first that we did?
Yeah, what was the very first show you did?
It was Women in Violence.
Yeah. So, and then was that based on stories that you were lying on the floor and telling each other?
Well,
yum.
Well, it was your impetus that you wanted to do a piece about women and violence, and that you wanted it to be funny.
Yeah.
And and you wanted to take back the prerogative of the joke, particularly the dirty joke, or any joke, actually. We wanted to put that into women's hands, because until then it was a man's hands. So the joke, the stories about violence, and what it means to be women. And that was what we started with. And the way we started is that Muriel asked each of us to think who would be our own personal clown. And it was out of creating those kinds of persona, that I like to call them, that we then began to tell, and felt safe enough, I think, to start to tell our own stories about our experiences with violence, or our understanding of women and violence.
Yeah.
And we put all of that together into a wonderful collage that was performed in the front of that very quilt.
Right. And when did you start using the quilt? That was around that time. Like, how did the quilt come into being?
Oh.
It was for Women and Violence that you put it together.
Because I was a sun dancer, at the end of the time you would get giveaways, and what women gave me were quilts, and so I came home, and I had quilts, and then Gloria came home from Kuneyala, and she had a huge mola, And then I got fabric from people. So I started to place different quilts. And I realized that I didn't want a set. Oh God, ladies, talk about sets, so no. But I didn't want a set then. And I just wanted something that we could put up and be part of. So that's what we did. But then after that, we asked the different actors that came in, the women that came in, if they would put something into the quilt. And that's how our quilt was built. So.
And when did Gloria and Lisa become part of this group? Was that from the very beginning?
That's sort of a... We never fight. The three sisters, she happened to have my oldest sister who passed away was in a Magic Circle Theater, and she was singing opera and doing things. And I was studying in Oberlin. And I came to New York one day, and someone took a photograph of the three of us. And we thought, we should be doing something with a background that we had of stories and so forth. Because we were telling stories since I was born, I think. Because my daughter tells me that she doesn't ask me questions because it takes too long. I said, it's a story, but it's true. And so there was a picture of the three of us. And that's my first memory of saying, yes, we gotta do something. So we threw our two cents into women and violence. But
I didn't see it that way. What I saw it was coming from great anger. It was the American Indian movement. Women were luxuries and were used as activity. And I firmly believed in the revolution of women as equal. And so I was coming from there, and the violence that I was seeing on the streets, in homes, and why nothing was being done. And that's where I came from, telling the stories and working. And I really wanted my sisters to be part of this. My older sister said, oh, but you do such crazy acting, you stand on your head and stuff, I don't want to do that, you know. But she was wearing a wig, of course. So, Gloria came, and she spent the summer. And it was just the beginning. I think I asked Lois then, right?
Yeah, I think I was the leftover from the other group.
Yes.
Yeah. We'd done,
and there was another woman who just had a baby, Ellen. She was married to a guy that used to be part of Open Theater.
Oh, yeah, I don't remember. Brandy, I remember. And
yeah.
I don't remember Ellen.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, Ellen, yeah, I do remember.
Yeah. Yeah.
I wanted to, but you, because you mentioned Open Theater, I also, because you talked about your impetus for doing Women in Violence, I think, you know, I was an enormous fan of the Open Theater as a college student, and I came to New York, and of course, the moment I came to New York, it disbanded, which was a great thing, because that means I got to study with Paul, I got to study with you, I got to work with people who were then working on their own. But you really were committed to telling women's stories, which I think was quite different than what your experience had been in Open Theater, that was telling a kind of universal story, which might mean a man's story. But I remember you talking about you wanted to bring that experience and those techniques into giving voice to women's stories and Native women's stories. And that was the birth of what I would call the feminism of Spiderwoman, was that desire to make those stories known.
Actually, can we show a clip from Cabaret? So while we're preparing
the cabaret,
so actually,
oh.
So this was a, this was one of the works that was sort of from, I think, 79. Spiderwoman in action. So I think what we're going to do is combine the last two chapters together. So we're going to say goodbye to Split Bridges, who said goodbye to Spiderwoman.
Peggy, didn't talk yet.
Yeah. Peggy, you want to talk and say something?
Sure. I came to Spiderwoman because Lisa asked me, but she didn't ask anyone else.
That's
so
right.
It was a mistake, but I was there, and what could they do? So there I was. That was pretty interesting. And then Lois and I left Spiderwoman a couple years later because we wanted to carry on the tradition that these guys had set up, which is, and the open theater, which is you want to go and do your own thing. So by then we were queer, and we had been hiding our sex that we were having in the bushes in Berlin and all that stuff. So so we decided to start our own company. So, and also the safe, we also wanted to make a safe place for queers and women. So we went and did that. And
You were also talking about you're in the show upstairs while someone's down here. One day we looked in the Village Voice. I was in Hot Peaches when I met Lisa, and I looked in the Village Voice one day, and at the same day, same weekend in New York, Spiderwoman, Hot Peaches, the Blue Lips, and the Ridiculous Theatrical Company were all doing a show.
Did you say Split
Bridges? Yeah, did I? Oh, I don't know. Yeah, we were all doing a show on this, and you know what? Everyone's still doing it. And I think that's to the credit of teaching each other that it doesn't. You don't have to be, you know, perfect and normal in order to do what you want to do. That we made a space for everyone to perform, and you can do it till you. Till you're old and die, and hopefully I'll die while I'm doing it. But I almost did. But I just want to say one thing about Joe Chaykin, because after he had a stroke, and me and Lois went to see his show after his stroke. He did a solo show, and he stood on the stage and without looking at anything, he gave a whole show. And I couldn't understand how he did it after a stroke. And then when we were leaving the theater, I turned around, the whole show was written on the back wall of the theater.
Yeah.
So I always remembered that. And when I had a stroke, I thought, how am I going to do that? Oh, Joe Chaykin. He wrote it all on the back of the theater. So we just wrote it on screens. Mm-hmm. You know, it was just the same thing. It gave you permission in order to be a real person rather than a phony person. So we all just carried on the same. Would you like to take the microphone?
I want to just say about the carrying on, that everything that I learned from you, Muriel, and seriously, and it's informed our practice, and that idea of carrying things on very much came from the permission you gave me to be anybody I wanted to be on stage, and to believe in the tiny details in our lives, and the fact that the mistake is the thing. Yeah. That is the thing. And I really appreciate that. Speaking of mistakes, all right, so we actually have, it's not that bad. So we have 30 minutes left for five hours of material. So I'd like to actually invite on the stage everyone from Misdemeanor Dream Now, and then to talk about everything together. If we could do that, could we call up the whole Misdemeanor Dream group to come on stage and talk about the next chapter of Spiderwoman?
Yeah. Come on, guys. Do we have enough chairs?
So, I'm going to talk about the next chapter of Spiderwoman and then everything all together. And then we're going to conclude with a showing of part of Misdemeanor Dream, which is the in-process show that this amazing group of people are preparing from their own stories that will be shown on starting March 9th, and that I've witnessed the evolution of, so I'm super excited. But I want to, you know, there was sort of a turning point where Split Bridges split, and Spiderwoman became just the work of Muriel, Gloria, and Lisa, focusing on Native stories and Native themes, and particularly stories from your own past, and really developing story weaving. And we're going to show a clip right now from one of the pieces that you guys did together. So it's Sun, Moon, and Feather. From some Moon and Feather. So we're going to do that first.
The boat story.
Don't you know the name? Okay, here we go.
Every summer, my family went to the beach. We had a big, beautiful red and white bungalow on a beautiful beach by a beautiful bay. Cedar Beach was an old bungalow on a dirty beach off a dirty, polluted bay. It was a fish house.
And twice a day there was a god-awful odor.
My father bought a big, beautiful red and white boat with a great big windshield and a great big motor.
That boat was just a little bit bigger than a rowboat. And it had a motor in it that never worked.
My father would stand at the helm of that boat with his brown safari hat on and his wooden staff. And he'd look out over the ocean. He was going to sail the seven seas. The only trouble was,
it never went into the water.
It just stayed in the backyard. And every summer, my father would paint it, cork it, pet it, hose it down, and then all our family and all our friends would come and we would push it to the other side of the yard.
And then we would hose by it, on it, and
under it. And Daddy and Uncle Joe would stand at the helm and pretend. And then next summer, my father would paint it, cork it, pet it, hose it down, and then all our family and all our friends would get together, and we'd push it to the other side of the yard. And then we would pose by it, on it, and under it. And Daddy and Uncle Joe would stand at the helm and pretend. And the next summer, my father would paint it and hawk it and pit it and hose it down. And all our friends and relatives would push it to the other side of the yard. And then one summer, it was ready to go into the water. My mother gave a party. She made punch, potato salad, and sandwiches. And all our friends and relatives into the water. It started to take on water. It was like a sieve. We had to bail out the water. And then it sunk. Then Daddy said, oh, well, next summer.
So the three of you, Muriel and Gloria and Lisa, you did a number of pieces together just with the three of you. I mean, was that a, did you feel that was a big shift to change just to focus on Native themes, or was that sort of happening in Spiderwoman before, in any case?
Well, one of the big things
I think happened was that we were absolutely adopted by Native communities, and we had to really talk about that we were role models. We didn't think of ourselves as role models because we were very busy trying to get food on the table, may earn money, get grants, and they were calling us role models, and we had to face that fact that we were role models. There's another story that what happened with that Navajo rag. I had this wonderful costume that showed my nipples and went down here and up, and this is funny, is Rosemary Richmond, Lance's mother, said she wanted that to be done in a back part of the community house. And I was begging her, I did not want to do it. She says, you have to do it. And I said, but they're gonna kill us when we do Navajo rag. And she said, we have to do it. We have to show what's there. So, okay, we were going to do it. Then she comes in and she looks at my costume and she says, Mrs. Mofsie's going to be Mrs. Mofsie's going to be here. You have to do something with your nipples. So she gave me Band-Aids. And I did the whole show with Band-Aids on my bosom. But the thing is that here, I mean, these were the real ladies that took care of everything, including you know, scaring the bejesus out of the ones who think they're so great. Yeah.
I just want to leap forward because I know that you worked together, as the three of you, for 10 years, 15 years, maybe 20, maybe 30, I don't know, a lot of years. but then around 2010, around the time that I met you and Loose Change Productions started to work together, was also a time when you were expanding to start working with other communities, other generations. I think at that point, Lisa was becoming ill, was not able to perform as much. And I remember when I first met you talking to you about how you wanted to include other generations, that how important that was to create a multi-generational kind of language. And then not long after that, you began to do these more collaborative works. You began to collaborate with Amitagzi up in Nipissing First Nation, who unfortunately they're not here because of the COVID world that we're in today, but Penny Cucci and Sid Bob are really important members of Spiderwoman, now collaborators, and have been so important in everything that has been done. But the first work that you guys did in a larger way, as far as I know, is Material Witness, which was done here at La Mama, which again was taking stories. You were working with the group of, with the ensemble of Native women, and this was focusing on violence against women in the Native community. And you were inviting these women of many ages to talk about their own stories of violence and creating, again, you know, like a very wild and crazy piece that was also dark. But I remember being very impressed by your saying, you know, you always need to leave open a window of hope. And I love that so much. And Gloria was a wonderful part of that piece, just opening. I just remember this kind of mythic opening of like almost just a mythical being emerging out of darkness.
But there was also what I remember, Foreign Lives of Onondaga.
I should. Asked us, she said, "Hey, you girls, you've got to go across your own country. You know, cause we had been fooling around in Europe, all through Europe." And so we came home one time and said, yeah, we have to do a story and take it across country and do workshops on reservations, which was very, it was very, very great for the heart, because on each reservation we met women who were having similar problems in life. And at the end of the show they would come and you know, call me sometimes and say, "That happened to me. With all the violence that happened in my life." And we realized that they should start groups of women to start their stories, to tell their stories. And that was we did a couple of years across country on reservations. That was very good. Yeah.
It was a very powerful show. It was wonderful. And I think we have a clip from Material Witness, right? I might just want to do the clip and then I'm going to do that.
It was the fall of the year and my best friend was coming to visit me in Toronto. I'd been living there for a year and we'd been friends for life. On the first morning, she wanted eggs and corned beef hash.
Told me to meet him at Sheridan Square Park.
Corned beef hash? Who loves corned beef hash? I've never liked corned beef hash, but she is so persistent. She always goes on and on and on. She's always been really bossy with me.
Have you seen her?
Have you seen her?
She's 12 years old.
She's 12 years old.
I didn't want to. Let's talk. Let's talk. I didn't want to, so I went.
We could buy anything, ham, bacon, sausage, but no, she wanted corned beef hash.
I cannot find her.
I cannot find her?
Have you seen her?
She's 12 years old.
So we went to find a diner.
He wanted me to go home with him. I said no.
Oh, look, she said, eggs and corned beef hash all day breakfast, $2.50. I'm not going in there, I said. I was not impressed.
She's 12 years old.
Have you seen her?
Have you seen her?
She's 12 years old.
She says, you see this knife? I could kill you right here.
Have you seen her? She's 12 years old.
Taped all over the front of the window with the menu written on in black marker. And there was cockroaches stuck between the tape and the window.
They plucked her little body from the river. Her little sweater that I knitted.
No pants.
No pants.
No panties.
No panties.
There was a man sitting next to me on the park bench. I said, call the police, he's got a knife.
She's 12 years old. Have you seen her?
Have you seen her? She's 12 years old.
She was so excited. You never get these prices in Northern Ontario, she said.
Pluck.
She really wanted to go in.
The cop comes over and goes, well, sister, this man bothering you? No, officer. She's my wife. My wife.
Pluck. I tell her about the bodies that I've seen thrown out the front door.
I look up at the officer. I go, it's all right. And I take him home with me and we make love.
And that we'd have to step over those bodies to get inside.
Pluck.
Pluck. That night with him laying next to me in the bed, I realized that he could kill me. I had all of his camping equipment in my apartment. Knives, hatchets. I got twine and I wrapped each knife.
Pluck.
Each hatchet. Pluck. And I put them out the window.
She is so persistent, she never stops talking. It's the smallest finder ever. You can reach the counter from your chair. But eggs and corned beef hash, all day breakfast for $2.50.
Out the window.
$2.50.
Out the window.
$2.50.
Out the window. Next morning he gets up, he goes, hey, where's my stuff? And I told him, I put it out the window.
She was plucked from me.
She was plucked from me.
She was plucked from her family.
She was plucked from her
family. She was plucked from her future. She was plucked from the universe.
She was plucked from the universe.
Pluck.
12 years old.
Pluck.
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 Pluck. Pluck.
So my friend and I went into the diner. Eggs and corned beef hash, all day breakfast for $2.50. I ordered the coffee.
A woman bursts in and backs into our table.
And a man runs in after her.
He hits her.
Come outside and we'll talk.
Hey, leave her alone.
Yeah, pick on someone your own size.
Call 911.
She hikes her miniskirt up and she sits her bare ass on our table. You want this?
You want this?
You want this?
You want this?
This is mine.
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 Ladies, these are my hands. Wrinkled, arthritic, but they're beautiful. Little hands. Big hands. Hands. A newborn. Clutches a finger. That's instinct. Long ago, that's how a baby stayed on its mother's body. With its hands. Big hands. Little hands.
Hands.
Look into the palm.
Thank you.
members from the current, again, collaborative piece, Misdemeanor Dream. And I'd love if each of you would introduce yourselves, just like a word or two, you know, your name. Like start Gloria back.
Okay.
Yeah.
Hello, my name is Imelda, and I am Ilocano, and I am originally from the mountain provinces in the Philippines, but I now reside in Canada. Hello again. My name is Hinu Josephine Tarrant, and in Misdemeanor Dreams, right now I'm playing the fairies, otherwise known as Sheila T, and Sky Woman. I'm Donna Couteau, citizen of the Sac and Fox Nation of Oklahoma, a longtime member with the Spider Women. I've been with you about 32 years off and on, you know? And I too broke off and I had Leaf Arrow Theater, and I was in the Misdemeanor Dreams, and also the Material Witness. And so it's just, it's wonderful to see that. It makes me cry just to see it. I don't know why, but anyway, happy to be here.
Queer, my name is Marjolaine McKenzie, and I'm from up north Quebec, called Matsumikushlakjon, Canada. yeah, I'm happy to be here.
Now she's a misdemeanor.
Hello, my name is Matt C. Cross, and I am a Kiowa actor originally from Oklahoma City and also a member of the Thunderbird American Indian Dancers, and I believe I am playing a character named Tiger Badger in Misdemeanor Dreams.
So we're gonna, before we see a little snippet from Misdemeanor Dreams in our waning moments, would you talk a little bit about the origin and development of Misdemeanor Dreams? So,
all right. What happened was I was fascinated with the idea of doing Midsummer Night's Dream, and I was thinking it would be great to have it done in many languages, many native languages, and someone ran it across Stratford Shakespeare Festival, and they got very excited about it, and they called me up, and and I could get anybody I wanted and anything I wanted, so that's what I did. I collected Native students that were... Native students that, you know, people I worked with, and I had about 12, I would say, of... And we did our thing, and we looked at spirits and little people and brownies, and we talked about the about our thoughts about magic and our thoughts about logic. And we had a great time. Unfortunately, Shakespeare, the festival itself, the professors and directors said things like, "I didn't know what I was looking at." And they got upset, and I also felt that I was not going to get what I wanted from them. They were trying to check off the list again of, you know, we have a native group. Check! So, and that's why you get grants. You get grants that way. And I really felt that this had to be us personally, Native people doing this, and that we are not in an institution, and that institution goes down and sends everything. So you end up being the, you know, the teaching you how to be a good little Indian or a good little colonist, you know, that this is a 101 colony making. So I decided that I wouldn't do that, and so I went away from the Shakespeare at that Stratford Festival. But then I wanted to do this. I wanted to talk about fairies. I wanted to talk about brownies. I wanted to talk about little people. And also, this was before COVID, I really wanted to explore and hold on to my language, Kuna, and what Kuna is, And so I got this Doris Duke Award, and one of the things I wanted to do was to really go out and really work and talk to native kunas and really learn the language. Unfortunately, COVID came in between that, so that didn't happen. But I talked to all the people that I'm working with, and that was like, how many? There's 12 of us, I think. And we did a reading at, what's the name of the place? Henry Street Playhouse, what?
Abrams
Center. And it was very exciting to do this, and I had 12 people on stage. Then what happened was the COVID really came in, and we just barely made it under, and so now everybody couldn't come to the States anymore. It was very hard. So what we wanted to really do this. So how do we do it? How do we do this with this whole new way of looking at theater? And how do we do it that some of us will not be able to touch each other? Some of us will not be able to hug each other. So I think it was Imelda talked about, well, let's try to look at it from the point of view of film or videos. So we started to look at it that way. But I didn't want it to feel like Gene Kelly with Mickey Mouse, you know? I really wanted to, that we were talking to each other, even if the person is on the floor and the other person is up there, that we can talk to each other. And also the thoughts of that being part of the spirits, being part of fairies, being part of little people, and being part of, you know, my mother talked about this all the time. So this new piece is really about that. It's about how we look at many things, how we look at planets growing, how we look at, someone said this and I thought it was so beautiful. So a lot of us have lost our languages. We cannot talk our language. And it was one of the saddest things when I had this big Zoom workshop and how we kind of exploded, because everyone was carrying the sadness of losing the language. And knowing that your father or your mother or both of them talked, but you're not going to hear it because it was easier for you to pass by not having the language. So there was a lot of sadness, and we were talking about it. And one of the speakers, Don Cavanaugh, said, you know, we haven't lost our language. We've just misplaced it for a while. And I thought, yes, that's where we are. That's what we're going to do. And that's our hope. And that we'll always have hope. You know, when you look at some of this and there's a window there, well, that's our window of hope. You know, that this is what we have to carry on. All of us, all 12 of us, we have to carry on that feeling of hope, and that we are not lost. And we have to think of it as, what is it we say? Their logic is our magic, or their magic is our logic. So that's yeah. Assuming.
Hey, Muriel, that I've been so inspired by you and by you, Gloria, and also by Lisa for the time that I knew her, just by your artistry and the depth of your exploration, you know, that you can really look at things that are so difficult, and yet you do it with kind of this joy and this gusto, and never, you know, you don't pull your punches, but you laugh while you're punching. So we're past time, but I want to conclude with Muriel, but don't we want to conclude with your performance?
Oh, yes.
Right.
But I want Muriel to talk before we do.
Okay, we have to be, we just have a couple, we're already
okay.
Past time.
It's,
Muriel, if you could come and just talk. And
yes.
So what do you want to know?
this is more family.
This is, you know, we're talking about what Spiderwoman Theater is, and we're sitting here with four generations of Native theater, and that is really important to me. And in this room, there is five generations of New York City Native peoples, down to, and we're all related to each other. You know, my husband, Kevin Tarrant, was Louis Mofsie's nephew, and he was, and Josephine. So it's like we're all connected. And the original Josephine, who was in Spider Woman, who did the spider weaving, she is the grandmother of my daughter, named Josephine, too. So I think what I'm finding very interesting is the interconnection that we're having. And also, what I was thinking, too, is when you were telling the story about Ellen Stewart, and how me and Mia, you had the same exact conversation when Bloody Bloody Andrew Jackson came out, and how we were so, and the public theater, you know, really wanted to do things a certain way, and we were fighting against it, and I was telling Mia about it, and Mia said, hey, you know, just come here. I want you here. And it was the same, you know, we find that happening all the time, right? I think the importance here about Native theater itself, I don't call things indigenous as much. I call things Native because I'm a Native woman. I'm a Native woman, and I'm a citizen of the Rappahannock Nation in Virginia. And so that's how I see myself. I say, you know, a lot of times it's like the BIPOC movement. I sometimes means invisible for indigenous. And I'm not interested in being invisible. Also, I'm talking, I have 3 minutes. Thank you. You asked me here, I was in my bed, home. I'm a menopausal woman, you know, I forget everything. My mother comes to shows and heckles me. I don't know what that is. But anyway, so then, you know, what I was thinking about memory. See, you see? And then you wonder why I get mad and do things. Well, let me continue. Anyway, when I decide to have my own, she's such a bully. I don't know. So when I started going into the business, as we call it, and we don't belong into the mafia, but you know, we're in the business. You know, I always say we're kind of like the Kennedys in a way, except we're not rich, or we think we're rich. And so one of the things I was thinking about is my experience with Spiderwoman Theater and what does that mean. And I remember something really well. I remember everyone going to dinner together, Aunt Gloria, you, Aunt Elizabeth, Lois, and Peggy, and you would all go, and you didn't feed us at Phoebe's. I had to beg for a hamburger. And if I wanted a soda, I remember the other day, Lois Weaver turned around and said, shut up and drink water. So I have a big experience with this. You know, I was told to shut up a lot as a kid. You know, that's why I have twitches. But all the influences of course, Don't Feed the Indians when I made my own group was the biggest influence I had because it was like, I was looking at the stuff, I said, oh wow, I really see, because cabaret, disgusting songs and pukey images really influenced me as an 11-year-old. There's nothing worse as an 8-year-old when everyone's telling jokes in second grade. And they tell you to tell a joke, and they're all telling child jokes, right? And you come across with, what's the difference between a Jew and a pizza? Oh, God. And you get called up on class all the time, right? So, I mean, you know, it was an interesting upbringing, you know. I don't remember all my friends when I was younger. They were all actors. And they taught me everything I know about theater now, from stage right and stage left. I still don't know my right and left because of that. And they thought I was dyslexic. So, you know, those are the experiences I've had as a young Native person, a theater person, growing up in this business and in this family. And also all the rehearsals exploding on the, you know, on the floor, right? You know, there's a lot of people, you know, we call it Blue Lips came, you know, and he had a dress on, and like, you know, we would bring, you know, it was all this, you know, I did not have, you know, a regular childhood, you know. I don't think I had a childhood, but I think that is the biggest influence of why I do this work. And in during interviews, you know, they ask me who are my biggest influences, and it's La Mama, Spiderwoman, Splitbridges, and Blue Lips. And people are always shocked because I, even though I'm making my own formation of how to run a Native theater company right now, that it comes to that essence and that seed. And I was just teaching last week, and I was talking about, there was something I taught, and it was theater is storytelling on an epic scale. And I truly believe that, but I believe that we have to start talking in our own point of views, all of us, especially in this call-out culture that we have, right? This call-out culture, what does it mean? What does decolonization mean? Is it just a word? We're all colonized, we have to understand that, but how do we go further with it? How do we decolonize spaces? You know, I was saying the decolonized spaces, you look at Hamilton, circle, circle, circle. Who invented circle? Indigenous people. You know, democracy. Circle, 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 democracy. Indian, right? You know, you feel like, you know, everything is really based, land that you're on, extraction, oil, on Indian land. You know, Americana, you know, red, white, and blue, and being Indian too. That, what, you know. So I find this all in this particular culture, in this call out culture, and particularly that we need to have a face, and that face has to be with allyship. And what does allyship truly mean to Native peoples? And what does that mean when a non-Indian takes space into the room? And how do we deal with that? And how do our allyships work within the city, within theater? Because I believe theater is just a metaphor for what our life is. You know, theater is life, you know. And I truly believe that. And I'm thinking that when I was looking at all of these clips, that I remember the makings of it when they were just being written down. I remember it being in the living room. I remember it being on 77th Avenue in Aunt Elizabeth's place. The one picture I know was in Aunt Elizabeth's bedroom, in the bed, you know. So, and then our honorary Spiderwoman was, there was two male honorary Spiderwomans, you know, Zdenek and Uncle Dave, right? So, and so those things happen, and where I was going is I'm very interested in not only a Native story, but a universal story that can also cross things, right? Oh, you want me to name the festival? Okay, so we're having a festival here that's collaborating with New York Theater Workshop and La Mama, and it is Reflections of Native Voices, but this year it's called Under Construction, because I believe that we're all under construction this year after COVID. And the other piece that is an outdoor piece that we are working on is called Feasts of Ghosts. And it's about mourning, and it's about how do we deal with death and what the land that you're on, land acknowledgement. It's more than just an acknowledgement, right? What can you give us? Are we gonna get our land back? Are you gonna give us our programming back? Are you gonna come on, you know, so land acknowledgements, that's nice, you know, you stole our land, okay, so we acknowledge that, but it isn't up for us to do that. You know, it's up for the non-Native theaters, it's up to the non-Native people in policy to turn around and say, no, we understand we're on land that was stolen. So on that note, that's all I have to say, because they want to get me off out of here, huh? Oh, safe harbors. Safe harbors started here in Safe Harbors, New York City. I don't know. She's so bossy. I don't know where she gets that from. Safe Harbors, New York City started with me, Nick, Billy, Josephine Tarrant, my husband, Kevin Tarrant, because after we saw Bloody Buddy Andrew Jackson, we had something to say. And I just want to say, Mom, that when I get celebrated, and Aunt Gloria too, both of you, is that when I'm now a professor at Brown, I'm a Mellon Fellow, And I'm working, and I just have to say, when people give me those things, they not only celebrate me and my family, but they celebrate these ladies, because everything I know about theater, I learned from them.
Wow.
I learned how to sing Pretty Woman.
welcome you to come to on March 9th to, or afterwards to the Misdemeanor Dreams. That was a, it's a piece in development, so it's being drawn from the story, from the personal lives of the actors involved, the members of the ensemble, as is the kind of in the tradition of Spiderwoman. And just come and support Spiderwoman Native Theater. And I hope you had a wonderful time today. And thanks again to Spiderwoman, to Muriel, to Gloria, and everything you've done for all of us. Really, thank you.